to welcome and introduce Dr. A.S. Ramasastry, Director, IDRBT. Over to you, Dr. Ramasastry.
Good morning to all of you who are joining this summit from various locations. It would have been a lovely thing to talk to you in person, but as you know, the circumstances today are different. And now we have to be in our respective locations, but still be able to interact. And this could be one way we are looking at even the topic that we are going to discuss today about the COVID-19 and cashless India. It's a totally different environment. Under these circumstances, I should really compliment ET for thinking in terms of a summit like this, and also congratulate them for making it such a successful thing, with participation from various people, not only from India, but from other parts of the country also. The topic they have chosen for the keynote address, and I would love to talk about it, is digital payments, COVID-19, and cashless India. I think the current circumstances, this is the right thing to discuss, and not only discuss, deliberate, and also take some key takeaways which could be useful in implementing digital payments on a big way in a country like ours. Even before getting into COVID-19 and the present system, I think we need to have a quick look at least digital payments in India. What is the ecosystem? In the ecosystem, the central bank plays a very important role in the digital payment space in India. The Reserve Bank of India has been doing three things consistently. One, it builds institutions. If you look at CCIL, if you look at NPCI and various other things, the Reserve Bank has taken the lead to build institutions that support payments and leading to digital payments. Reserve Bank plays two roles simultaneously, which is very difficult for any central bank. It is both a regulator and also enabler of payment systems in India. It's a rare thing that a central bank takes two hats simultaneously and does both reasonably successfully. As a regulator, it has to ensure that payments are in the right direction and they are in the interest of all the payment system participants. Simultaneously, they also look at as enablers. And in the process, the last recent initiatives could be the payment system vision document that Reserve Bank of India has brought out, which most of you might have seen. And if you had not seen, I think that's a document which we should refer continuously for looking at payment system in India. The second one is an Andhra Nilakandi report on the deepening of digital payments, which discusses various aspects related to technology and the requirements and gives good specific suggestions for many of us to take, pick it up and start moving ahead. And this is also a RBI committee. RBI also does, as an enabler, which we did recently, conducts payment system innovation contest to fintechs to helping them to come out with new ideas. So on one side, we have Reserve Bank of India, though a regulator, also helping to develop digital payments in the country. Then you have organizations like NPCI and good infrastructure supporting the entire nation in the form of IMPS, UPI, BEAM. This one is a good infrastructure development that is done by NPCI. We have banks, and the banks play a very important role in banking and payments. And we have different entities like PPIs, payment gateways, and the supporting systems around in the form of telcos, system integrators, and fintechs. Now, the fintechs are the ones which can drive the digital payments from the technology perspective in the coming future. I think the roadmap is more or less going to be driven by the fintechs in the coming future, and the whole ecosystem should see that the fintechs play the right role. In fact, Reserve Bank of India is playing very closely with fintechs. NPCI works with fintechs, banks work with fintechs. I think everybody is working with fintechs, and now the country is looking at fintechs as the future for the digital payments, like any other things that they are able to do. I think this is the entire ecosystem with which we are going to work. Yeah. Now, in these circumstances, the COVID-19 came. It's not that anybody expected it to come, and actually it is not something which anybody would even think of that it coming. Now, for us to see whether this can be a catalyst. It's not that we are not moving towards digital payments. If you look at the earlier slide, we looked at various players of the ecosystem trying to bring in digital payments. But can COVID be a catalyst? The first thing that is happening with COVID-19 is a social distancing. People are not coming close to each other. And what brings them closer? That's a digital proximity. Even in the case of payments, when people are not touching each other, seeing each other, probably digital can play an important role. Then there could be, already it is, cash could be a taboo, not because cash is something which is like a currency to be cash, but in the case of COVID-19, people don't want even to touch something which is touched by the others without knowing what is its path that it has taken. So cash could be a taboo, in which case contactless transactions. By contactless, both, we have been talking of contactless in the term of cardless, those kind of things. Now it is like people are also not contacting each other. That could be the second reason it can play a catalyst role. Any difficult situation leads to different solutions. Probably COVID-19 will throw up several opportunities to bring out solutions, which is already doing. And technology innovation will be very, very fast. We cannot wait because it is something which we have to quickly innovate and it will be timely implementation. It's not that anybody would delay an implementation of a good innovation provided it is there, because COVID-19, as we are seeing today, was not a 2 months, 3 months lockdown, but it could be a long-term adjustment of the entire nation towards social distancing and towards contactlessness. So under these circumstances, possibly COVID can play a role of the catalyst in enhancing digital payments in the country. See, this is a two-way matrix. It may be difficult for all of you to read, but let me explain what I'm trying to present in this form. There are many enablers. There are many reasons why the digital payments could take off. On one side is technology. On the other side is the applications. The first thought that keeps coming to me whenever I look at COVID-19 is, had this COVID or this pandemic had struck us about 25 to 30 years back, I did not know how the banking would have been. Because banking today is able to reach all its customers, all its services, or most of its services, because technology-enabled banking. Similarly, payments have been technology-enabled in the sense that we are not as we were 30 years or 35 years back, when we had to depend on actually physical branches and physical transactions. We moved far away from that. And that's one of the reasons why today we can say technology can help us in enhancing digital payments. The new technologies that are possibly enablers, because it's something which we have to discuss in detail, would be the IoT, Internet of Things, which most of us are using in one way or other in different forms. The second one is the distributed ledger technology, more popularly called as blockchain. And this could be, this again, we have to see where all its usable users can be. And artificial intelligence and machine learning, they play a very important role in most of the technology related things, and could be AR and VR. We are seeing a lot of its activities, a lot of its applications in various fields, and probably payments also could be one of such fields. So on the technology side, we have IoT, we have distributed ledger technology, we have AI and ML, we have AR and VR. On the other side, if you look at the column wise, you want these applications, these requirements are there. One, light cash or less cash. We don't want to deal with cash. This is not a new idea. This is there for quite some time within the country and across the globe. Then a different customer experience. We want it as smooth as possible. It should not be like difficult to do these transactions. So we have to look at customer experience as another important thing. Then can we think in terms of personalized service? The payments also can be very personalized. And fourth one, which is what we have been talking for long, whether it is right time for us to make a big way of micropayments. Now, even small payments, short payments, all they can be automated, all can be transferred. I think if you look at this matrix, I tried to fill some of the cells, but it can never be exhaustive. It can never be the exact roadmap, because we can pick up something else from here, there, move it around, and maybe make a combination of AR, VR with AI, ML, and maybe with some IoT, and come up with a product and service which will make the experience totally different. We keep talking about various new experiences that are likely to come, and highly personalized service, either in terms of banking or in terms of payments, and possibly the micropayments. I think this is roughly the enabling part or the environment in which we are looking at COVID-19 and digital payments. I would like to highlight a few of these things. This is our possibilities. There are big impact changes. The first thing when we look at India, it could be case with many other countries, even cases like Thailand or any other countries whose participants are there in the summit, is that India has got multiple types of customers or multiple type of people whom we have to cater to. On one side, we have urban and rural. On the second side, we have elite and not so elite. On the third, we have got illiterate and illiterate. And fourth important things, we have already financially included and some who are not financially are not so much included. I won't say not included because all efforts have made most of the people to be included financially also. So these are four different types of way to look at the people whom these digital payments have to help. It could be urban and rural, it could be literate and illiterate, it could be financially included, not so well included, or it could be elite and not so elite. So all these kinds of people, the products, the services have to be designed and to be delivered in such a way that people can still continue to use your payments very efficiently, even if they are not able to move out or even if they are not able to do the transaction physically. One big thing most of the central banks are looking at, not necessarily because of COVID-19, but its process started even earlier, is the central bank digital currencies, CBDC. A lot of discussion has been taking place, including BIS discusses, some banks, some central banks like China and some in Europe and even Thailand, they are also looking at possibilities of implementing CBDC. So CBDC has two ways to look at. One is the wholesale, the second is retail. Wholesale means the central bank giving to banks at that level, it would be a central bank digital currency. And banks onwards, when it goes to retail, banks can design their own products and services. The second thing, it could be even used as retail. This need not be confused or not thought as a cryptocurrency, which has its own reasons not to adopt by some of the countries and central banks. This is actually going to be a substitute for the cash currency, and central banks can look at it seriously, and many other central banks are doing, and there is some thinking going on in our country also, whether it's the time to look at CBDC. And if COVID-19 situation continues for some time, possibly all banks, all central banks may look at it either at wholesale level or at retail level. This is one thing that is going to happen. The second one, as I was telling, the people who are not fully into the financial inclusion, we need to put in place several payments which could be automated. Now, part of it has already started because governments and state governments have started doing their subsidies, their pensions, and all those things are automated and credited into the bank account of the ultimate beneficiary. Now, the beneficiary to start paying to whomever they are supposed to pay, these payments also, if they are automated, actually all payments are done through digital, but with very minimal or almost no intervention required by many of the players. Because those payments have to take place, they can be automated, and these necessary systems to be designed for that. So automated payments to and from all to enhance financial inclusion could be an important thing that can be thought of. Now, for the urban elite, or what you call as people who love to use the gadgets and geeks like people, we can think in terms of products where IoT comes into picture, where AI comes into picture, where so many other things come or put together. Your wallet becomes a wallet. You walk into a shop, you just look at a few things, may take experience them even virtually, and if you like them, you just buy them and make the payment also through your wallet kind of thing. So it's a combined experience. It's not that payments alone work. Along with payments, so many other things are also inbuilt into it, but you just walk with wearables and do whatever you want to do. You test, experience, buy, and any other things that you want to do. As far as the micropayments are concerned, possibly, this has been started by a few, maybe in terms of audio, movies, and other things, but it can be extended to several other things. In fact, if you look at the digital journals, you pay for the article that you read. But still, it is not that kind of micropayment which is automated. So probably automated micropayments, which case most of the small payments which we are doing through currency or coins or even through cards, they all can go away. They may not be there as we are seeing them, provided these payments along with the second one, like automated payments and micro payments, like parking, you do your car also has an IoT, recognizes the car, it knows how much time it has spent, and a payment made, like FASTags are doing for the when you are going through roads. Same thing, similar kind of things are potential possibilities which can be used to take the digital payments to the next level. And also, it is a bot-guided, now the world becomes more and more bot, bot-guided savings, consumption, investments, and payments. So all these things, you know, your entire income is analyzed, and it also knows what all things it needs to purchase, and the payments are made, and goods are delivered, or services are captured, and investments are made. It's an entire ecosystem being developed as a parallel, where you manage the highly personalized management of the individual's incomes, wealth, and all done through digital means, a payment being one of the biggest things. So interestingly, what in this economy, our economy is driven by the payments. I mean, because that is the parallel to all the goods and services. So if you are able to digitize most of the payments, and you quicken the process of the services which are virtual, and make deliveries as an infrastructure developed, possibly you look at a world which is totally different, which is what the COVID-19 sufferers or people who are living in COVID-19 would love to have. I don't need to move out. I'm at home. And even if I move out, I know where I move without any contact. So I'll be able to do most of my payments and get my services done. And if the first one happens, that the central bank digital currencies become very, very popular, in which case cash is already substituted by a digital currency, which is actually moving on the digital channels. And so the payments can become very effective, very fast, and very convenient. But one thing we have to keep in mind when we think of all these things is the security. Because as you move more and more towards the technology and automated, and where your controls are handed over to the systems to take care, we should ensure that security is of the highest level. You cannot compromise on them. Because if security lapse is there, and people lose trust, and the trust is lost, the whole edifice crumbles. We talk of digital payments as long as people are willing to take it. People will be willing to take it if you give convenience and simultaneously trust. So when you are building, when you are conceiving, when you are thinking of any innovation in digital payment, you look at the convenience of the ultimate user and simultaneously give him full trust. And the trust comes from the security that we are able to build. So the path is now very clear. There is a good ecosystem already in place. There are several technologies to enable us. There are requirements of the people who will be able to make use of it. Now, as the providers of the, as the people who are able to think about these digital payments in a big way, it is for us to discuss, deliberate, and try to come out with the right kind of solutions which will take India onto a cash-light society where we use less cash, but we'll be able to transact, we'll be able to do whatever we want to do things. So with these ideas, like what is the ecosystem, how we'll be able to make use of, what are the new areas that can be thought of, and how to strengthen the whole thing, I wish a very good deliberations throughout the day and a grand success to the entire summit. Thank you. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much for your keynote address, Dr. Ramasastri. I think it was a wonderful keynote and it sets the tone for the panels and discussions to follow. Thank you for your time. Thank you, Dr. Ramasastri.
Thank you.